Blackie Etude by Chopin, written in 1830. And it's called the Blackie Etude because the right hand only plays one note piece, the rest of them are black notes. So that's big. The next piece I'm going to play is an original composition that I wrote. It was the first piece that I ever wrote. And I started back in 2019 after going to a music camp here. And I learned about something really cool, at least for a music nerd like me, called a figured bass. And it like, I was like, oh, I want to try and like write a piece with using this. So that's how I started. And then I didn't finish it until 2021, 2 years later, a composition competition. And this piece is pretty special to me because it was what first got me into composition, which is what I'm planning on majoring in right now. So I'm tuning into major. Thank you. for Rachmaninoff is a pretty tame piece. It's kind of like why I like it. But the next piece I'm going to play is by Maurice Ravel, who was a French impressionist composer in the late 1800s into mostly the early 1900s. And so this is a little background on this piece. Ravel was part of a group of artists, poets, critics, and musicians known as Les Apaches. To pay tribute to them, Ravel composed Mirrors, which is a set of pieces that this piece is from, and he dedicated each movement to one of the members of the group. And Un Barque sur l'Océan, or A Boat on the Ocean, was dedicated to the painter Paul Sardin.
Thank you.
Sections. It's a set of three piano and cello duets, which Bodhi Star will be playing with me, which you're not here in a second. So the first one, called, it was originally Morning Fog, but then I had to come up with a name for the whole set, so now it's Morning and the whole thing is, that one's Fog. Anyways, that doesn't matter. But, so I started composing this one at the beginning of last year, and we were finally emerging out of COVID, and it was also amidst like my junior year, which is, for all you high schoolers, you know, it's very stressful. I was kind of, the idea of fog in my mind was how I felt. So I kind of like this heaviness, and like I couldn't really see the light yet, like some kind of Tangled song. But anyways, so I composed this with an idea that originally it was just going to be one piece where it was going to be fog and then the fog burns off and then you can't see the light. But then it kind of became like super long, so now it's three pieces. So I composed the third one before the second one. Dawn was composed. It came from a piano improv I recorded in May of last year, and then I just transcribed it and made it, arranged it for piano and cello. And then I finished Rainfall 4 days ago. Rainfall, props to Bodhi for learning it in a couple days. It's still kind of a rough draft, so it's not completely done, but it's what I got. So, yeah, so the whole progression is there's the fog, which is the heaviness and that, like, just badness, I guess. And then to Rainfall, which I personally really like rain, but rain can also often symbolize bad things. So it's the things in life that can bring you a lot of joy, but a lot of pain. And then the last one is Dawn, when that fog burns off, the rain and the clouds like lift, and it's just a wrap. So that's Morning. More than, sorry. These pieces directly transition into the next one, so don't clap until they're all done. Now it's done. Thank you. So he kept it in his mind the whole way home, and then when he got to his piano, he recorded it. So the connection was. Here's Misty.
Thank you.
I first performed it my freshman year, which was 2020, right before quarantine, like 3 days before quarantine, actually. Anyways, so here's some interesting history about Rhapsody of Blue, at least I find it interesting. But, so Paul Whiteman, who was a band leader in New York in the 20s, commissioned George Gershwin, who this is by, to write a jazz concerto for him because he was coming up with this new experimental concert that featured a lot of interesting jazz and classical like mix-ups and stuff like that. So he commissioned him on November 1st, 1923, but Gershwin respectfully declined because he didn't think he would have enough time, seeing that the concert was in February. So a couple months later, on January 3rd, 1924, Ira Gershwin, which is George's brother, showed him a newspaper article that said that it talked about Whiteman's upcoming concert, and it's like, George Gershwin is writing this amazing jazz concerto that's going to be performed there, like premiered, and he's like, what? I'm not doing that. So he called him the next day and was like, what's this about? And he's like, well, my rival is trying to do the same thing, and I need it to be done first. So basically, he had 1 month to compose this, which he thought he had a short amount of time 2 months prior. So he went right to work on it. And this is a quote from Gershwin when he first kind of started it. It was on a train with its steely rhythms, its rattly bang, that is so often so stimulating to a composer. I frequently hear music in the very heart of the noise. And there, I suddenly heard, and even saw on paper, the complete construction of the Rhapsody from beginning to end. No new themes came to me, but I worked on the thematic material already in my mind and tried to conceive the composition as a whole. I heard it as a sort of musical kaleidoscope in America, of our vast melting pot, of our unduplicated national pep, of our metropolitan madness. By the time I reached Boston, I had a definite plot of the piece as distinguished from its actual substance. So we finished the piece just like in 2 weeks, somehow. Well, he actually didn't write a lot of it. I'll get to that in a second. So it was composed for two pianos, which is what we're doing, but it was orchestrated by Whiteman's arranger, Frede Graffe, or something like that, how I say his name. And so he was the one that did the orchestration of the accompanying part, and he finished that on February 4th, 8 days before the concert. That's the amount of time they had to learn it. It was premiered on February 12th, 1924, and Gershwin, for most of the solo sections, just improvised them, and then it would nod when the orchestra was supposed to come back in. So what we're actually playing was probably not what played at the premiere, at least for the solo parts, but it's close. So here is Rhapsody in Blue. Thank you.
Thank you.
Parkinson, who allowed me to use the space for a lot cheaper. And also thanks to Julie for all of her wonderful teaching, and John, our sound tech, and to all of you guys for coming. Have a good night. Oh yeah, so we have refreshments up a flight of stairs or the elevator. It's on the third floor, and then that way, it's like a lounge.